Hello guys, welcome back. Until now we have learnt about variables, we have learnt about arrays, we learnt about pointers, and in that process we saw many other concepts, okay? But everywhere there was a small problem. For example, when we used single variables to store different values, there was a problem. That problem we overcome using an array. In an array, we can store any number of elements but all of similar types. Then what if we have elements which have dissimilar types? For example, if you want to store one integer, one float, one character, and one maybe double or a long variable, then what do you do? Until now, we do not have any such concept. That's why today we will learn about structures in this video. So what are structures and why do we use them? So structures are a collection of several variables, and these variables can be of any type. Structures are generally used to represent a record. For example, if you have a record of a book or you have a record of some student. So in those cases, we have maybe book ID, which is an integer. We have author name, which is obviously a character or a collection of characters. Then we have the contact number maybe of the author or any other important information. So all those things have different data types. And in order to represent all those data types under one umbrella, we use structures. One more thing, why we use structures? See, you might have a question that if we have such varied information about anything, then we can always store, maybe we can use a character array to store the name of the book, a character array to store the name of an author, then again some integer to store maybe book ID, then a float variable or a double variable to store the book price. But that doesn't work out pretty well, because if you do it in that manner, then you will be able to store record of only one book inside one variable. So if you have to store the record of maybe multiple books, say 10 books or 5 books or maybe 100 books, then you'll have to declare several such variables, which is not very handy and it is not either feasible. So in order to overcome that problem, we use structures. When we do a small example using structures, we will see an example of a book and how do we simplify the process by using structures. Now we come to memory allocations to structure. Structures are allocated memory as per the members that are contained inside the structure. For example, if you have two integers, say ID1 and ID2, then both of them will occupy 4 bytes each, because an integer has size of 4 bytes. Similarly, if you have say two characters, then they will occupy 1 byte each, because size of a character is 1 byte. And if you have a float, then that float variable will occupy again 4 bytes, because size of a float is 4 bytes. In most of the places, you will find it is written that rather size of a structure is same as the total size of all the member variables inside the structures. But that is not always true, because whenever you declare any structure, we have one concept of structure padding, which gets implicitly added into it. For example, if we have a structure with two integers, two characters, and one float variable, and we want to store it in this fashion. First, we write int ID1, then we write int ID2, then we declare two characters A and B, and then we declare one float. So in this case, one extra padding gets inserted. Why does that happen? Because size of this float variable is 4 bytes. Now, if you sum this up, integer will occupy 4 bytes, this will occupy 4 bytes, that is 8 bytes. Then again, these two characters together will occupy 2 bytes. So 8 plus 2 is 10. Now, if you want to store another float, then immediately after 10, we have memory location 11. But obviously, that memory location 11 is not a multiple of 4. So that's why referencing this particular location in memory becomes difficult. And hence, the compiler by itself introduces a padding of 2 bytes. And that 2 bytes contains nothing. It is just blank. It's just empty. Till these two characters, we had total size 10. Now, if an extra padding of 2 empty bytes is added, then we have 10 plus 2, 12. And after that, we can always start storing this float variable over there. And the index of that float will, or memory index of that float will start from 12, because memory referencing begins from 0. You can always search over the internet for structure padding and you will get everything in details. This topic is not included in your syllabus, but still I discussed so as to give you a clear-cut concept. We shall also see that how It affects the size of the total size of the structure by using a simple code later on. We can have, just like we have pointers to normal variables or normal arrays, we can also have pointers to structures. For example, if you have a structure array of structure variables, maybe you have a structure whose structure variable is b, and you are declaring 10 such structure variable array. The member variables of the structures are suppose name and price. So b0 will refer to this first group of these two variables, then b1 will refer to another such group, similarly until b9. So b9 will also refer to two such variables. Now if you declare a pointer, say struct book star p, here book is the name of the pointer, or rather name of the structure. So if you declare a pointer as struct book star p, then this will point to the first location, that is b0. We shall see that again using code.
Okay, so let us now get into the code for structures. So first of all, okay, let me just remove this. I had written this for simplicity, but anyways, let's first write struct, let us say anything, xyz, anything. Inside this, we will have int a, char b, float, let's say c, and again char d. Now we'll write main, void main. Inside this main, I will declare int size, and let's say size. Okay, for that I also need to declare the object, so struct xyz obj. So this obj is the structure variable or object for this particular structure xyz. Now size is equal to size of obj, and let's now print the size. Size is percentage d size. Now as per our expectation, what we expect is size of int is 4 bytes, for char 1 byte, for float again 4 byte, and for again the char 1 byte. So the total size comes out to be 10. But what you'll see is it's not actually the case. The total size over here will come out to be 16. And why it is so, I'll tell you. See, the total size is 16. Now what happens actually is this, this concept is known as structure padding. And this entire concept is not even part of your syllabus, but just for your knowledge and for interview preparation as well. They may ask this question in interview. It's a very important question, very important concept actually in structures. That is the concept of structure padding. Even if you search over the internet, you will get it. The concept is known as structure padding. Okay. In this case, what happens is the compiler by default to be able to handle memory much efficiently or in a much better way, the compiler itself aligns the structure to multiples of 4. Not the structure, but the members of the structure to multiples of 4. See, over here we have int a. So this int a is taking 4 bytes. So this is first block of 4 bytes. Then we have another block of 1 byte. Then let's keep one space. And then we have a float. So again 4 bytes. Let's again keep a space. And then we have 1 byte. Okay. Actually, this space is not needed. So in this case, we have 4 bytes, that is 0 to 3. Well, after that we have this 4 again. Then again, this 4 bytes that will obviously start with 5. But 5 is not a multiple of 4. Now our memory, what happens is, the computer memory is designed in such a manner that actually if you see, everything is a multiple of 2 or 4 you can say. But 5 is not a multiple of 4. So that is why in order to be capable of handling memory efficiently, This compiler introduces a extra padding. So this padding is of 3 bytes over here. Why? Because the first one is the 4 bytes, and again we must have 4 bytes so that the next 4 byte can be aligned as per the requirement of the compiler or the memory. Excuse me. So this is our 4 bytes. One byte is the legitimate space that is required for this character. This 3 bytes is the extra that's getting wasted. Again, we have this 4 bytes of legit space, 1 byte of legit space again. But then after this one also, there is an extra padding of 3 bytes, which is again introduced by the compiler. Because if you want to accommodate anything other than 1 byte or 2 bytes after this char, that is, if you want to accommodate any long variable or double type variable or any int or float, it must be aligned with a multiple of 4. So obviously there has to be a padding of 3 bytes. Now this one, it showed us the size to be how much? 16. Now you see, if I put a char over here, say char e, it will not make any difference. The size will again come out to be 16. It does not change. Here also, if you include one more char, say char f, or maybe one more char g, it will not make any change. The size will still remain as 16. Why? Because it is, when you are including two more characters, what is happening is actually this size has got increased by 2 bytes, that is 1 plus 2. So it becomes 3, and this size gets reduced by 1, because now when I have 3 characters over here, in order to make it a multiple of 4, we need only 1 byte extra. So this one, this 1 byte of padding itself will suffice in order to provide that necessary alignment. That is why there is no change in the size of structure. Okay, what happened? Yeah, so there is no change in the size of the structure. Now over here, if you introduce, instead of this f and g, if you introduce a maybe float over here, float, say float f, the size will again change to 20. See, the size has got changed to 20. Why? Because over here your 1 byte was occupied, there was 3 extra bytes of padding, and again that you have introduced this one more 4, extra 4 bytes of space needs to be occupied, because this f cannot be accommodated within this 3 bytes. So this 3 bytes are getting wasted, and one extra 4 bytes of space needs to be allocated for the f that you have put in over here. So this is not an efficient memory handling. Instead, what can be done is, whatever you have to declare, which is of already a multiple of 4, you declare it at the beginning. And then, if you have to declare any characters, just declare it at the end. So instead of doing this, see, what I'm doing is, we have this scenario. Over here, the size shows to be 20. Now in the same scenario, what I'll do is, I'll remove this one from here, and I'll just put it over here. So this will now reduce the size by 4 bytes. So you see the size has got reduced to 16. So this is how you handle memory efficiently. Okay, so that was all about structure padding. And now another thing, that is the last thing that I'll be talking about in structures. I've already written this program, but I'll explain it to you. See, in the earlier program, I had written this keyword over here. This struct is actually a keyword which we use in order to declare any structure. So this is a keyword, this is the name of the structure, and this, what I created, is the structure variable or structure object, which we say. This is our structure variable, okay, or we also call it as object of the structure, okay. Structure variable or object. Now we need this object. In this case, first of all, I have declared this object inside main, so it is obviously not global, it is local to this main. But if we write it outside, it will be global. So why we need this structure object? We need this in order to be able to access the elements inside the structure. If we directly write anything, any element, say A, C or F, if we directly try to access it, it will show up an error. We won't be able to access it directly because it is a member of the structure. So that's why you see any member that I've tried to access over here, I've accessed using this structure. I will explain to you this code. What's happening over here is, see, I've made a structure and the name of the structure is books. Now you notice that I have included one file over here, one header file over here, that is string.h. This header file I have included over here to be able to use this string copy function. What it does is, this is my structure variable object subject, and inside this I want to store this value, that is C programming. So instead of taking any input, I have not taken any input from the user, because this was just for an explanation of how structures work. So in input, you are very much capable of taking the input yourself. So just in order to assign value to this subject variable, I have used this string copy function. Okay, this is a built-in function which is defined inside the string.h library or string.h header file. So what that does is, it will just take this value, that is C programming or Y Kanetkar or let us see whatever. It will take this value and copy it inside this one. Okay, now coming to the code. So this is our structure. Inside the structure, we have one int and three character arrays. One is that book ID, this is subject, this is author name, and this one is book title. Okay, now in order to assign values to this, I have first, yeah, one thing that you must notice, I have used two structure objects. See, struct books book one, struct books book two. So I have made two objects of the structure, of the same structure. Now these two objects are completely completely different from each other, not at all identical. Okay, because see, if you consider the memory, assigned, then for this book one, there is a completely different block that is assigned for all the variables inside this structure, and for book two, there is a completely different space that is assigned for all these variables again. So basically, this book one and book two have got nothing in common. They have their own different space. They obviously have a different, name. So everything is different. Now, whatever the values you will assign, even those values will be differently assigned to both book one and book two. So what I'm doing is, it's book one dot book ID is equal to one. So I'm assigning the value one to this particular book ID, which belongs to structure object book one. Okay. And similarly over here, I am assigning this value two to the book ID variable, which belongs to structure object book two. So obviously this one and this one, both are completely different. Why different? Because the structure object over here is different. So this is a very important thing, which maybe you'll make some mistakes while you start off, but with practice you'll get to understand it very, very well. It's a very simple concept. Now coming to the next part, that is book one dot subject, book one dot author name, book one dot title. So I'm basically assigning these three values to these three variables respectively. Similarly over here, I've written book two dot subject, book two dot author name, and book two dot book title. So I have done nothing but I've just assigned values to all the variables inside the structure for both the structure objects. Now what I'm doing is, once the values are assigned, I want to print these values. So in order to print these, I'm making a call to this print book function, which I have defined over here. So inside this print book, what I'm doing is, I'm just printing out the values of these variables. Now notice one thing, that I've called this print book function two times, that is twice. So why I've done that? Because I have created two objects over here. So the first call is for the first object, and the second call is for the second object. So essentially, whenever this past value, or this book one and book two, whenever it will go over here, we will obviously come inside this, that is b.bookid. So when I'm passing book one, this b refers to all the structure members which are a part of this structure variable or this object. So the values that will turn up on the screen will be the values for this particular object. Next time when I'm making a call using book2, the values that will get printed will be for this object, that is book2. So let us see the output once. The output shows book ID 1, let us see C programming Y Kanitkar. So these are the values which were present for book 1. And similarly for book 2 we had this Java programming, Herbert Schild and Java the complete reference. So that is what we have over here, book title, subject and author. Okay, so that was for book 1 and book 2. Similarly, what you can do is actually, see, over here I have written book 1, book 2, and if you want n number of objects, you can go till book n. But that is not an efficient way. So what I will instead do is, I'll write book 0, I'll write 2. That means I want to make an array of structures and the size of the array is 2. So over here, I will write book 0. That is normal array indexing, nothing else. This will be book 0. This will also be book 0. And over here I will write book 1. Here also book 1. Book 1. Okay. In this case, we'll have to put book 0 over here. And here it will be book 1. Probably that should work. Let us see. Yes, it's giving us the same output. So it makes no difference whether you are declaring it n number of variables or whether you are declaring a structure. Okay, we had also learned about dynamic memory allocation. So over here also you can perform dynamic memory allocation if you want. Okay. Now one more thing that I'd like to show you is, let us simplify this code first. What I want to show you is how to use pointers. So when I am using normal objects, I'm using this dot notation over here, that is book.bookid, book.subject, book.authorname. But when we will use pointer, we will see that the notation has changed slightly, and that notation will be an arrow notation and not dot notation. So first of all, let us see if this code works. Let's just verify it once. Yeah, it's working. Now I will make it a pointer. So if I make it a pointer, this needs to be an arrow operator over here instead of this dots. Similarly, if I'm passing a pointer over here, obviously I need to have a pointer over here as well to accept the values. And inside this also, I need to have these arrows. Let's see if it works. Okay, there's some issue. Let's see what happened. Okay. It's not pointing to anything. So I have struct books book. Struct books ptr, and let us say ptr is equal to ampersand book. Pretty simple. So we'll need to change it a little. Now let us see what happened. Ptr, oh, what's wrong? Obviously. Print book. What happened? Incomplete. Okay. This will be again PTR. Yeah. So it's working perfectly. So other than those few silly mistakes, there was no error. So basically, see, what I wanted to show is not how to work with pointers, rather I wanted to show you how to handle structures using pointer. So not much of a difference. The only difference lies in this notation or the syntax. So when you are using normal structure variable like book, you are using the dot notation. But for this one, for pointers, you use this arrow notation. Okay, I'll just comment out over here. Use dot notations for normal structure variables and for pointers use arrow notation. So that is the only basic difference between how to use a normal structure variable and how to use a pointer structure variable, or a structure variable that points to some whatever structure. Okay, so that is all for this video. Thank you, and I'll suggest you to, you know, practice the structures very nicely, because you can expect one long answer question from this part in your semester exam as well. So study structures very properly and do revise the concept, or do study this concept of structure padding in details. It's a very important concept. Okay, so that's all. Thank you.